In this video, I'll be telling you about BJT, that is bipolar junction transistor. Before beginning, if you are new to my channel, please do subscribe to my channel. And if you like the video, please click the like button. Now BJT is a three-terminal semiconductor device. Okay. Now here with the name bipolar junction transistor, the name bipolar itself tells that the current conduction takes place due to two carriers, that is holes and the electrons. Okay, now also it is called as current control current source device. Now why it is called as current control current source device? The main reason is that BJTs are basically used for current signal amplification. Okay, and here the working of the BJT is controlled by the current. Therefore it is called as current control current source device. Now let's look at the structure of the BJT. Now here the structure of the BJT you can see. Now the structure of the BJT consists of emitter region, base region and the collector region. This is the emitter base junction and this is the collector base junction. Okay. Now basically the function of the emitter is to provide the majority electrons. Majority carriers, not as such electrons, carriers. Either it can be electrons or holes. And your base region is basically the sandwiched between the emitter and the collector region. And your collector region, the function is to collect the carriers. Okay, it will, the function of the collector is to collect the carriers. And basically in BJT what happens is that you are usually this collector base junction is reverse biased for easy handling of the BJT. Okay, now we will look next is the doping level. Now we'll look at the doping levels of each region. Now emitter region is heavily doped. Now the main reason is because it has to provide majority carriers, therefore it is heavily doped. And the base region is lightly doped, whereas collector is moderately doped, greater than base region but less than emitter region. Okay. Now depending on there are two types of BJTs. There are two types of BJTs, namely NPN and PNP. In NPN you can see that a p-type material is sandwiched between two n-type materials, and in PNP you can see that an n-type material is sandwiched between two p-type materials. Okay, now here the symbols of transistors, you can see the arrowhead here on the emitter terminal indicates the flow of current. Okay, now here you can see this is negative, positive, negative, positive, negative, positive. Okay, now here the conduction takes place due to the majority carrier, that is the electrons. And here the conduction takes place because of the majority carriers, they are the holes. Okay, next is the operating region. Here for a region of operation is required for AC amplification, and for that purpose you require proper DC biasing of this BJT. Okay, next is working of the transistor. Now we look at the working of the transistor with a suitable diagram. Now this is the diagram. Now here I've used NPN transistor. Okay, now you can see that basically this a transistor can be seen as two PN junctions back to back, right? You can see that it has two PN junction back to back, that is an NPN transistor. Okay, now here you can see that this voltage VEB is your emitter base voltage and this is your collector base voltage, collector current IC, and you have IE. Okay, now whenever there is a flow of current in the emitter base junction, what happens is that your electrons in the emitter move towards the base. Since base is lightly doped, some of the electrons which have moved will combine with the holes present in the base, leading to the current IB, which is very small. Okay, maybe maybe in microamperes, and the remaining will reach to the collector, constituting collector current. So basically this IB and this collector current together constitute your IE, that is emitter current. So basically this happens when your emitter and base is forward bias and collector and base is reverse bias. As you can see here, base emitter. Here we are looking about the current components of the transistor. Now we'll look at this diagram. In this diagram all the current components are shown, that is hole current at the emitter, hole current at the collector, electron current at the emitter, and the reverse saturation current, and this is the recombination current. We'll see how this current came into picture. Now here you can see that it is emitter base voltage and this is a collector base voltage. Okay. Now here, there is no supply voltage to the transistor is said to be unbiased. Okay. In that case, what happens is that the current there is no flow of current. Okay. And whenever you supply voltage to the transistor in such a way that your emitter and your base is forward bias and your collector and base is reverse bias. In that case, there is a potential variation happening at the emitter junction and the collector junction. Okay, due to which there is a flow of current. Okay, now here the emitter current you can see clearly from the image that it consists of hole current at the emitter and the electron current at the emitter. Okay, now here whenever your emitter junction is forward bias, emitter base junction is forward bias. Here you can see that holes moving from the emitter to the collector. In bargain, not all will move to the collector. Okay, few will recombine at the base. Here, these holes will recombine with the electrons in the base, leading to the recombination current, which is given by IPE minus IPC, where IPE is the hole current at the emitter, and IPE is the hole current at the collector. Okay. Now, here you can see that when if IE is equal to 0, what happens is that IPC will also will be equal to 0, which will lead to the reverse saturation current ICU. Okay. Now, this reverse saturation current basically consists of the holes which moving from base to the collector and the electrons which move from the collector to the base. Okay. Now, at this point of time, your IC will be equal to ICU. Okay. And if IE is not equal to 0, okay, if it is not equal to 0, what happens is that your IC will be equal to ICO plus IPC. Okay, if it is not equal to 0, it will be equal to ICO plus IPC. That is, ICO is the reverse saturation current. And here, whenever this is the total current IC will be alpha times IE plus ICO, where alpha is the current amplification factor. Okay, I will see what is alpha in the later stage. Now here we look at the performance parameters of the BJT. The first parameter is the emitter injection efficiency, that is the gamma, which gives you the proportion of the hole current to the total current flowing through the emitter junction when forward bias in case of PNP. Now here you can see the formula, that is current of injected hole carriers at the emitter junction to the total emitter current, that is hole current at the emitter upon the hole current at the emitter plus electron current at the emitter. Now you can see that if the value of gamma will be approaching 1 if your INE is very small as compared to IPE. Yes or no? Now for this to happen, your base should be lightly doped. And this is the reason why your base is lightly doped. Okay. Next is base transport factor, that is beta, measures the amount of the base current required to transport the current from the emitter to the collector. Okay, now here it's basically the amount of current which is required, base current which is required to transport your current from the emitter to the collector. Now here the transport capacity depends upon the value of beta. It will increase with the increase in the beta value, and beta value will increase only when your base width is less. Okay, so beta is equal to IC upon IB. Now let's look at the next, that is current amplification factor, that is alpha, which gives the ratio of the collector current, that is the holes reaching to the collector, to the emitter current, that is electrons injected from the emitter. Alpha is equal to IC upon IE. Now here from the expression you can see that mostly IE will be value higher than that of the IC, because the majority carriers which are injected from the emitter not all reach to the collector, which will lead to the lower value of the collector current, as some of them will recombine in the base region, right? Therefore from here, from that you can make a conclusion that alpha should be always less than 1. Okay, thank you for watching my video.